नमस्कार। ए फॉर साइंस इज अवर यूट्यूब चैनल। थ्रू दिस चैनल वी प्रेजेंट्स फंडामेंटल्स ऑफ फिजिक्स विच इज अ वीडियो लेक्चर सीरीज बाय मी। दिस इज अ प्रीलूड टू द सीरीज। इन दिस सीरीज आई इंटेंड टू टॉक अबाउट फंडामेंटल्स ऑफ फिजिक्स राइट फ्रॉम द जीरो लेवल, that is the level which is taught in the elementary schools and elementary courses of physics. The idea of the series is to start from the zero level and to build up the foundation for advanced topics and concepts in the physics which are discussed even at master levels, like quantum field theory, standard model of high energy physics and standard model of cosmology and other disciplines, and also to point out questions which are yet to be answered in the domain of physics. Please have patience with me and bear with me as some inadvertent error may occur while I speak or make presentation, and some omissions and mistakes may also occur, and my apology for the same. And I would try to correct the same in the revised editions of this particular talk. Bear with me also for my limited proficiency in English. And later, I also intend to make this series available in a bilingual format involving English and Hindi. At the outset, I also wish to make a disclaimer that this series of video lecture is based on my understanding of the subject, which I have acquired from different books and various other resources, including web resources, and therefore it is more likely that the ideas, perspectives, contributions and original works of many experts may appear in it without my giving explicit credit to them. I am using the content with the spirit that I am here to propagate their ideas further. So the presenter, which means me, has used contents available from several resources to propagate their ideas further through making this presentation, and not for making any personal claim or profit or authority. So I acknowledge, and at the outset also I salute all philosophers, scientists, technologists, engineers, mathematicians and the teachers of science, technology, engineering and mathematics. This particular series is dedicated to my parents and grandparents. So I begin the prelude of the series with the very important question: what is science? Maybe there is no definite and unique answer to the question, what is science? We all know that as an academic discipline, the discourse on the science began with the subjects or disciplines like natural philosophy and natural history in 16th, 17th century. And these subjects of natural philosophy and natural history are now known as different subjects like physics, chemistry, biology, etc. So the natural philosophy and natural history, as it evolves, it becomes clear that the science is a way of acquiring, way of doing science is a way of acquiring the knowledge by following certain methodology or methods which we call scientific method. So science can also be considered as a set of knowledge which has been acquired through a systematic methodology, scientific methods, about which definitely we will be able to understand better as we progress further in the series and as we pursue the science and learn the science. What community of scientists believe or accept as a science, that can only be taken as a science, because there are many claims of pseudosciences being propagated as the subjects of science. But in my personal opinion, the community of scientists, if accept something as a science, it should be accepted as a science or discipline in science. when you learn and understand further through this series or otherwise, then you will be better able to understand the answer to the question, what is science? But let us begin with also some broad categories of science. One broad category is natural sciences. Physics is one of the natural sciences. The other big category, which is even older than these natural sciences, and that is formal, mathematical or abstract sciences. And these formal and mathematical and abstract sciences may have historical beginning even in the era which we call before Common Era. So many have taught about and many concepts have been developed even in the Sumerian civilization or in Indus Valley civilization. And so there are different claims about that. Applied sciences, engineering and technology is the one disciplines related to the science which makes it popular, because the kind of development and achievement which we have made to make the life of human beings better, the science is often appreciated because being backbone of engineering and technology, and that's also part of science in my industry. So another type of sciences which are being taught in universities are called social sciences, and I will avoid any inclusion or discussion of social sciences in my presentation to the extent possible. So to me, all the branches of science, technology, engineering and mathematics in a broader sense will be considered as a science in this series of presentation. However, I would be primarily focusing on learning of the subject which is better known as physics, as this particular video lecture series aims at fundamentals of physics. But there will be many ideas which have overlapping importance and meaning in the different disciplines of science, technology, engineering and mathematics. So even if you are not primarily interested in pursuing science as a physics as a science, then also the series of lecture may be useful to you if you are a student of STEM at any level. Carl Sagan has said that science is a way of thinking more than a body of knowledge, and that should be emphasized during the period of learning as well as when you progress further and when you pursue science. You must understand that's a way of thinking, and unless you absorb that way of thinking or you adopt that way of thinking, the learning of science will become futile. Many students do learn science in unscientific manner or in the manner which is not consistent with what Carl Sagan has said, that it's a way of thinking more than a body of knowledge. So you can throw in and memorize many scientific facts, and so if a question is asked, then you can reproduce the answers of the question based on your memory, but that is not the method of science or learning science or doing science. We have to adopt that the science is for also for all, because in modern times it is for everyone. There cannot be any section of the society for which it is not meaningful or useful in pursuit of life. Or at the same time, I wish to emphasize here that science is in modern period not only for Homo sapiens, because now we have presence of what we call non-biological intelligence or artificial intelligence. So we have citizens like Sophia which are social humanoid, and the scenario will change very fast, and therefore the science is not only for Homo sapiens, but the AI or intelligent machines or the machines which can understand and make learning. More and more people will need be required in coming days of time to learn and pursue science, and maybe the primary activity of the human beings and also the machines will be engaging themselves in this STEM. And that's why STEM skills are very important. And as a subject, physics or science, any discipline of the science, you must understand that what does a study of a discipline involves. A study of a discipline, for example physics, involves a language and with technical terms, with notions, with concepts and with associated semantics. And if you don't understand that language, So anyone who has not started and made an attempt to understand the language, the technical terms, notions and concepts will not be able to make out anything from a book, an advanced book of a physics course. So it's important that we pay emphasis to the language of science. So language of physics here will be discussed, and the fundamentals of that language will therefore be in a way very, very important for us in our discussion and deliberation in this series lecture. Then it also refers to a set of objects and an ontology, which means a set of objects to which it refers to, and that you must be clear to you. And so the discussion is limited to that ontology only. Third aspect is that it is an epistemology, and therefore it's a body which of knowledge which constitutes and not only how to acquire, not only the method to acquire this knowledge and validate this knowledge, all are part of, in my understanding, of the epistemology of the discipline. So there are methods and tools with which we have to acquaint ourselves to understand the subject of the discipline further. And that is why we require a set of theoretical perspective, and a perfect understanding of theoretical perspective is very, very important. And as a theoretician, I would emphasize that without a theoretical perspective, the science cannot be pursued effectively, and it cannot be, it is not desired at all. That with a theoretical perspective only, the scientific experiments and the methods of interpretation would make sense. So criteria for acceptability of science may have emphasis on the experimental agreement, but acceptability criteria cannot be applied without keeping in mind the theoretical perspective. But there is a well-established criteria of acceptability of a knowledge as scientific knowledge, which you would come to know as we progress further in this series of lecture. So I would be primarily interested in the natural science. Natural science involves both scientific experiments and theoretical framework. An experiment, as Max Planck has said, is a question which science poses to nature, and a measurement is the recording of the nature's answers. So it's very clear to you that in scientific experiments, measurements or observations are made and recorded. And then based on the theoretical framework, those things are discussed and analyzed, and the evolution or development take place in science. So a scientific theory is a contemplative and rational type of abstract or generalized thinking about a natural phenomenon or the result of such thinking. It deals with a comprehensive explanation of some aspect of nature or natural phenomenon that is supported by a vast body of evidence. And so scientific theoretical frameworks, however, are tentative and can be discarded, and the entire theoretical framework can be discarded on the basis of non-agreement with the experiment. So far we have noted that scientific experiment is a procedure carried out to support, refute or validate what we call a scientific hypothesis or scientific theory. And the theoretical frameworks or theories are represented as collections of concepts, propositions, statements or belief, etc., and their logical consequences, or what we call laws. Now, which comes first, theory or experiment? That question cannot be answered. And as you understand science, you understand that this is not a meaningful question at all. Because in history, it is we learn that Higgs boson was theorized first in 1964, and it was observed later in experiment in 2012. So the theoretical prediction of Higgs boson preceded the experimental observation of Higgs boson in 2012. But at the same time, we know that the electron was observed first by Thomson in 1897 in an experiment, and its proper theory, the theory of the electron, and a more meaningful theory of the electron, was later developed by Dirac in 1928. So sometimes experiment takes lead and sometimes theory takes lead in the course of scientific progress or development. Now, to understand theory, you have to understand both the conceptual structure of the theory as well as the mathematical structure of the theoretical framework. So every theoretical framework involves two conceptual structure as well as mathematical structure. And as pointed out earlier, it has a language. And this language doesn't mean natural language only. And the terms and notions which are used by using terms and notions of natural language, but a formal language also. And as we know that each language, whether natural or formal, can be considered as sum of syntax, semantics, and pragmatics. And semantics is very, very important in understanding of this science, because the words or notions or concepts which we use in scientific deliberations or discussions or learning, they may have different meaning in different contexts or in different theoretical framework. So the word particle, for example, which will appear very soon in our course of discussion, this word particle has different semantics. We will begin with the semantics of the particle in Newtonian mechanics. And there we say that particle is a hypothetical physical system which has point size, which is structureless or indivisible, and which has certain physical characteristics like mass. So that is the Newtonian point of view, or the meaning of particle in the Newtonian mechanics. Now the same meaning you cannot carry forward to the advanced theories like the quantum field theory. In quantum field theory, when we will come to that and when we will learn quantum field theory, then we will be able to realize that the meaning of particle. And so nowadays, whenever you say electron as a particle, it simply refers to a quanta of a corresponding field, and which is created from vacuum by use of corresponding creation or creation operators. So this is very important that the points and concepts have meaning, and concepts have meaning, notions have meanings, terms have meanings associated with semantics, but that semantics is dependent on the frame of theoretical framework under consideration. So during the entire series, you will have to take note of it, that whatever is being discussed is in a particular theoretical framework, and the statements which are being made have a particular meaning in that theoretical framework only. And so when we progress further in the series, then we will be able to discover that the meanings are changing, the concepts are changing, the phenomenon, the nature is same, natural phenomenon occur in a particular manner, but our interpretation of natural phenomenon is based on theoretical framework and as well as experimental observation. Sometimes experimental observations compel us to reject a theoretical framework and build up a new theoretical framework. That is why the journey of science is very, very interesting, and it is fun of you. A word may have some meaning in theory and may have different meaning in another theory. I hope you have taken that as granted now, from now. And so there are certain concepts which are concepts in a particular theoretical framework, but are not useful as concept in other theoretical framework. For example, when the word force appears in Newtonian mechanics, it has been properly conceptualized in Newtonian mechanics. Force is a concept in Newtonian mechanics, but you don't need force as a concept in quantum field theory. So questions also have answers which keep on changing as we change the theoretical framework, because our understanding or interpretation of scientific knowledge is based on theoretical framework. So the questions, very simple sounding questions like what do you mean by an electron, may have different meaning in different theoretical framework. And so same thing can be said about what do you mean by a spin. And so in classical physics, the spin may have a different meaning than what we find as meaning of spin in quantum mechanics or quantum theories or quantum spin. And similarly, very simple questions like what causes fall of an apple may have different answers and different explanations in different theoretical framework. And so that thing we have to absorb and realize that the answers to the questions in science are tentative. And as the science or scientific knowledge is pursued and we progress further and new development take place, the answers may keep on changing. So the truth in science is always tentative. For example, in giving this series of lectures, very soon we will come to the Newtonian mechanics and you would find an answer for the question, what causes fall of an apple? And fall of an apple in Newtonian mechanics is attributed to the gravitational force exerted by the earth on the apple. And we will discuss the dynamics of the free fall in our series lectures. But then what we find that the black holes cannot exist in a Newtonian universe or in a universe where Newtonian mechanics is obeyed at all levels. And in such a universe, the black hole existence is not possible. Now, all of you who are listening to this series may have already knowledge about black holes. Black holes have been experimentally observed. And so once you observe and once you have an experimental evidence of observation of black hole, it also amounts to say that the Newtonian theory of gravitation or the theory of gravitation which you will discuss or learn first in Newtonian mechanics has been discarded as a final scientific understanding is the concern. And so fortunately, the Einstein proposed a new theory of gravitation which is better known as general theory of relativity. Towards that also we will come during the in the series after many lectures definitely. But the Newtonian explanation can be replaced by the explanation given by GTR, and GTR is to be considered or is considered as a better theory of gravitation than Newtonian theory of gravitation. You would be able to appreciate and understand this fact through this series of lectures and through your learning of science and physics. So the explanation in GTR doesn't involve the force, exertion of force by Earth, and the language of the same phenomenon, the free fall of an apple, explanation of the free fall of an apple involves new concepts, new terms, and which requires a new kind of mathematical understanding also, mathematical knowledge, and that's called curvature of space-time. And the pole is attributed to curvature of space-time. So this is to say that it's very, very interesting thing. Learning science is full of fun. You learn, then you de-learn, and you have to relearn. So even if you have learned Newtonian mechanics very well, and sometimes when you learn a particular theory and you become a master and of the knowledge of that particular theory, you feel very happy. But very soon you may discover that the theory has limitations, or it has been proved in the history of science that the theory doesn't withstand the experimental agreement test, and therefore we have to move further. And we have to de-learn and relearn the new theory. The new theory which has been proposed must not only explain all the phenomena which have been explained by the previous theory, but it should have explanation for something new which cannot be explained by the previous theory. In this way, the scientific knowledge or scientific discipline has been progressing, and that is true with the physics also. So as you learn physics of a particular type, then you find that that particular type of knowledge which you are acquired is based on a theoretical framework, and then you have to relearn that theoretical framework and relearn a new theoretical framework to understand. So it will be a long journey of understanding science in this manner, because till we get the ultimate and final answers. And for just your information, that there are no final and ultimate answers available as on today in the subject of physics or science in general. And so the progresses will keep on happening and we will have to keep tracks of the situation. At the same time, because I am starting this particular video lecture series with the students and teachers as an audience in mind, and so I wish to emphasize here that the learning objectives and especially the cognitive objectives of the learning, which have been discussed and proposed and theorized by Benjamin Bloom, and to put my kind of presentation in a proper perspective. So in the Benjamin Bloom's learning cognitive objectives of the learning, or educational objectives, or taxonomy of educational objective, it has been made clear that the lowest level in the pyramid, which is shown here, is the knowledge or remember. So through books, through literature, through this series of lectures, you would acquire certain information which can be considered as scientific knowledge or scientific information, and then you would tend to remember that information. So that is the very first step. Unless you acquaint, for example, yourself with the concept, knowledge about concepts, for example, you would not be able to progress further. But so these things keep on featuring. But knowledge and remembering is one thing, and one can remember things in such a manner that if this question is asked, then this kind of answer should be given, and that can be called a mapping. So you can map answers to questions and memorize answers of many questions, and you may think that you have become or you have acquired a good knowledge, but that will not be a real case. Understanding is very, very important, and understanding requires much deeper cognitive exercises than the knowledge, and maybe the kind of the information which you may collect may be very large, but you may not be able to understand each and everything. But when you pursue or develop understanding of a particular subject, then definitely understanding is important, and as much you can understand out of it, that much should be aimed at. So it is clear from the Benjamin Bloom's pyramid that the entire set of knowledge, maybe you cannot acquire the proper understanding, but if you have a maximum level of understanding of the informations which you have acquired through your learning methods, then that would be very helpful. And it will be helpful in applying the knowledge, because scientific knowledge or scientific learning, the minimal objective can be to apply the knowledge. If you have knowledge at your command, and even if you understand it, if you do not acquire the capacity of applying that knowledge to solve problems, then it's not very, very important as far as utilitarian aspect is concerned. And so, yes, as a scientist, you must think of applying whatever you have learned to that particular level. And in that manner, one can move further in the understanding or better understanding of the science. Application of knowledge is very, very important, and which involve applications of rules, methods, concepts, principles, laws, and various things which appears in theory. And applying require not only complete understanding, because wrong understanding would imply wrong application, and you may come to wrong conclusion. So for a proper application of scientific knowledge, it is essential that you have better understanding and clear and concept clear understanding. That is why people say, and students many times share with me, that the fundamentals are very, very important. Because fundamentals, having good fundamentals in physics simply means that having better understanding, and therefore having better capacity to apply that knowledge and to apply that knowledge to solve problems. So every discipline involves a lot of exercise in solving problems. And when we solve problems, maybe we have may have alternate methods also of the solving the problems. And so after studying all possible methods at a level, we may analyze the kind of the scenario which exist in that particular discipline or subject or for the kind of problem which we are interested in. And so analyzing becomes important after applications. So there may be different kinds of applications on the same system for understanding or for analysis. And analysis therefore does not involve a single application, but maybe comparatively analysis of all the prospects which are there. And after analyzing, you can evaluate, and the evaluation can ultimately show you the path to creation of the new knowledge. Yes, an ultimate objective of scientific learning or pursuing science is to create new level of understanding, new level of scientific knowledge, and new level of theoretical knowledge, new level of experimental progress, and so on. So after that, I come back to my original question, what is science and what is natural science? So science, if we take as a simple answer, systematic study of nature is called science. As I've already said, there can be many answers, but let us begin with this particular answer, that systematic study of nature is science. So it's a very small phrase, systematic study of nature, and three words appear in it, systematic, study, and nature. So we will question one by one each of them. So what do you mean by nature? And there may be different meanings, semantics associated with the word nature in language. But here, in my understanding, and so for our video lecture series understanding, we will say that by nature, we mean the set of all natural systems. So there are something called systems, and which we call natural systems, and all those natural systems taken together define the nature. So systematic study of nature means systematic studies of this natural system. And what is a system? A system is either an object or set of objects or set of a particular class of objects which have been specifically chosen for the study. In making the study, it is very, very important that we have to choose a system or a set of object for the particular type of study. And that is the approach of science, which can be called systematic in the manner that if you want to address all natural phenomena in one go, that is not possible. So for example, very soon we will be discussing about kinematics of particle. So the particle is there as chosen system, and we will describe and develop the language for description of the kinematics of that particle. However, particle, as I have earlier said, is a hypothetical system which is not existing in the real world and is not directly accessible in experiment. But we will consider the study of dynamics of a particle also as a component of physics, because it helps us in understanding the dynamics of bodies, dynamics of a football or dynamics of a cricket ball. In Newtonian mechanics, we can make an understanding out of it, without particle being a hypothetical system, because we can consider a body as made of particles. So a system sometimes can be divided into subsystem, and a system is either a collection of subsystem. Then we have various important philosophical questions would also arise, whether the concept of divisibility works perfectly, that system is just sum of parts, or whether the system's behavior is different than the what we expect from sum of the parts philosophical approach. And so we will find later in the course that the physicists, when they develop theory and present theories, they first pay attention to simple, but ultimately the real world systems are much complex systems, and that's why we have to increase our understanding to that level, and we have to deal with the complexity. And especially this century, 21st century, will be remembered for complexity. Most of those scientific programs and research which is being pursued right now pay attention and focus on complex systems and complex dynamics, and many new ideas are very, very important in this context. So what is a criteria to call something as a natural system? And that criteria to me is very simple. Either it should be accessible in scientific experiment so that you can perform the experiment on it and you can check the ideas of theory or theoretical predictions can be checked and theories can be rejected or temporarily accepted for further discussion. And the system should be either accessible in the scientific experiment or it is likely to be accessible in scientific experiments. So as I have pointed out that the Higgs boson when was theoretically proposed was not accessible in experiment at that period of time, but it was likely to be accessible in future experiment, and it became accessible in experiments. In 2012 we observed the experimental evidence for the existence of Higgs, and so that's the scenario. Any system which is accessible or likely to be accessible, and in some case when even if it is an hypothetical and likely to be accessible in a hypothetical experiment, it will be considered as part of science. So there are many examples which you can consider, and if you prepare the list will be never ending. And so cosmic objects are natural systems, so celestial objects are also natural systems, so all geographical objects are natural systems, our Earth is a natural system, all biological species, so we ourselves are also natural systems, chemical species, mechanical systems and so on. So the list goes on and on, the natural system, and that's why in the science these systems may be made of subsystems, and therefore a question always arises, what are ultimate constituents of all the systems taken together called as natural system, the set of natural system which comprises our universe. Then what are ultimate constituents of our universe, and what is the ultimate behavior, and what best understanding we can have about the universe would also come up. But definitely something, if you conceptualize in such a manner that it is neither accessible nor it is likely to be accessible in future experiment, then that will be considered beyond the domain of science. And that is why to me, and the limited knowledge which I have, the concepts like which have been introduced in literature like soul, God, ghost, these are beyond science because these are not scientific or natural system, and that's why more often they are called supernatural system. So anything which is supernatural will not be considered. Now when we say system, so every system, natural system, any natural system you pick will have certain characteristics. So every system is characterized by certain things, a feature, a quality, and sometimes you can express this characteristics of a system only in quantitative manner as you conceptualize, and more often in physics we would go for, and after Galileo we have been following it, that as far as possible if we can measure the characteristics of a system, so quantitative description would be involved, and that helps in understanding of the behavior of the system. The characteristics of a system may be of classified as intrinsic characteristics as well as extrinsic characteristics. Intrinsic means which is characteristic of a system by virtue of its existence or being. Like when in Newtonian mechanics you say mass of a ball may be intrinsic characteristics of that particular ball. But extrinsic characteristic is the characteristics when you describe a phenomenon, and in that phenomenon it may be attributed to the system in the manner in which the theoretical view or analysis is being carried out. So for example, kinetic energy of a ball is an extrinsic characteristic of the system, because if you will give different answers also sometimes for this kind of characteristics, if you change the frame of reference, the value of extrinsic characteristic will depend upon the choice of frame of reference. As we progress further, we will be able to learn more and more about that. But whenever you learn or acquire knowledge about a particular characteristic of a system, you should think about whether the characteristic being talked about is an intrinsic one or it is an extrinsic one. So based on the characteristics, we classify these different branches of science. So in biology, we study what we call biological systems, or the systems which possess biological characteristics. And the similar notions can be extended, that in chemistry you study chemical systems and in physics you study physical system. But there is a reductionist view and approach, that all biological systems are aggregation of chemical subsystem. So biological systems can be ultimately, in reductionist approach, can be understood in terms of chemical subsystems or in underlying biochemistry. And similarly, all chemical systems are made of aggregation of, or are made of physical systems. So they can be considered, or their behavior can be ultimately explained in terms of laws of the physics or physical systems. So that's why physics is considered as a fundamental science and very, very important, because other branches of science, which other branches of natural science, I will say, I exclude in this discussion the mathematical sciences or formal sciences. Formal sciences are abstract. They do not refer to any constituent of nature or natural system. So that is very important. However, they also refer to certain kinds of objects, which you will, and we will, whenever it will become important, you will take it up. That physics, therefore, is a fundamental science, and physics has many, many branches. And as we progress in this series of lecture, then we will come across these branches of physics: mechanics, thermodynamics, optics, electromagnetism, and so on. So many branches of classical physics, and then we will come to modern physics, quantum physics, new theories and new kinds of branches. Same thing, same phenomenon may be interpreted in a different manner, but that is essential, because the old theory is inadequate to explain the physical phenomenon. So we would adopt a new set of theories, which we call quantum theory, and all classical theories which we will learn will be true only under certain limitations and approximations. And finally, in our discussions, we will come to the topics of high energy physics and cosmology, which are of my prime interest and concern. So coming back to the characteristics, physical characteristics is the characteristics which is possessed by a physical system. So my definition is very simple: every physical system possesses a set of physical characteristics. These characteristics can be described in either qualitative manner or quantitative manner. More and more we will rely on quantitative description of physical characteristics, but I cannot say or guarantee that qualitative things and qualitative description and ideas would not appear in our course of discussion and learning. So qualitative involves comparative, superlative, descriptive, subjective, and these kinds of notions, and qualitative involves, and quantitative involves expression in terms of numbers, but how they are expressed in terms of number and what kind of numbers, that would also be very interesting, and we will come to that in our course of discussion. So for example, in initial course of discussion also, we will come across this knowledge that a physical quantity is described in terms of numbers, a set of numbers, maybe more than one number, but then it also has certain units and it also has dimensions. And so a physical quantity also has some kind of character, which we call tensorial character, and that refers to that when we make a transformation of the body of knowledge which we have in one frame of reference to another frame of reference, how the knowledge will get transformed, how scenario will change in description, that is very, very important, and that will be associated with what we call tensorial character. We'll come to that, the details of that, so don't get bothered by that. Tensorial character is a high sounding term, but it's very, very important as far as fundamental of physics, understandings of fundamentals of physics is concerned. I have noticed in my career that many students do not understand the importance of tensorial characters of physical quantities in real terms, And so that makes a handicap for them to understand effectively or better understanding of concepts of physics and apply the same in theoretical as well as experimental studies. So the physical quantity, whenever will arise a new physical quantity, we will introduce to understand the characteristics of a system. We will have to think about the number, unit, dimensions and tensorial character. But at the same time, there are certain important notions, like notion of whether the physical quantity is absolute, which means can it be specified without giving any reference to a frame of reference or a system of reference, or it is relative to a frame of reference. These questions are very important. Sometimes what we do, that we try to memorize things without having a proper understanding of a physical quantity in terms of these aspects. So that would be emphasized in this series of lecture. Now, what do we mean by systematic study? So you have understood nature, set of natural system. You understood system is either an object or set of objects chosen for a specific study. And so the first thing that we have chosen that particular system, so that is the first part of systematic study. But what does systematic study involve? Systematic study involves that every system is existing in some state, and that I call state of the system. So specifying or describing the state of the system is part of the study. Next thing is, which is more important, that the system will not remain in the same state of the same state for all time. Or maybe if something happens, it's a state of the system may change. And therefore, the change is very common. And if there is no change, if system remains in the same state, maybe it is of not much importance in scientific exploration. And because we cannot make of the knowledge of just description of the state of the system is not useful. And that's why it's very important that the specification of state of the system is there, but realization that the state of the system may change with time, may change with change in parameters or conditions, other parameters and conditions. In that way, we have to describe also in a scientific study the changes which are happening in the system. And finally, therefore, we will pay address to what are the laws of nature, laws of physics, whatever you call, the divine laws which are governing these changes. Had there been no change in the state of system, we would not need law if a system is static and remains as such. But as we notice that the state of the physical system will change, so we have to pay attention to the fact that the changes are arbitrary, can happen in any way, and whatever be the new state, or there are certain rules or laws of nature chosen by nature. And these are also called divine laws, because most of the time when law will appear in our discussion, laws of physics in this course will be divine laws, which means never changing, and which means we assume that the laws are constant. They do not change with time, and everything else change with time. So anything which does not change with time in scientific understanding can be called divine. And otherwise, being part of nature, the change is the characteristic or a behavior of nature which is common. And the change is the change in a physical state or in a state of the system is also often classified when we understand and try to understand it in terms of what we call phenomenon. Some kind of change, we can give a name of a particular phenomenon, like free fall of an apple is a phenomenon. And it also involves the change in the position of the apple with respect to the center of the earth or the surface of the earth. Then these laws which we will come across in our discussions and learning, these laws sometimes, because we don't know the fundamental basis or theoretical basis, these laws are framed on the basis of empirical basis, based on observations. Based on recorded observations, we make certain postulates, assumptions, and call them laws. For example, Newtonian laws of motions, which you will learn first, are empirical laws. And there can be laws which, as appear in the theoretical discussion, can be derived from other principles which have been assumed in that particular theoretical framework. So there can be two kinds of laws: laws which are empirical, which are pure from observations with no explanation, just assumed to be correct, and they are said to be correct because there is no evidence against them in experiments or observation. All the time experiments and observations are in tune with them, so we call those laws as empirical laws, and laws which are derived from the basic principles. So from certain basic principles, earlier if you have been considering something as a law of nature, empirical law of nature, you may derive it from a basic principle, and that basic principle would be an assumption maybe in the theory. So these topics will become more and more clear to you as we proceed further. So why we need to know the law? Because laws are governing the changes, and if you understand laws of nature, laws of physics, if you understand the systems and its description and how it should be studied, then we have the capacity to apply law and predict change. So ultimate aim is to predict change, predict the behavior of the system, and to make out something of it. Maybe it would be very useful to us for doing something, for finding solution to another problem. Because all the intellectual exercise is the exercise in solving problems. So the solving problem is always at our mind, and solving problems require application of the knowledge and understanding, and another understanding will be acquired therefore in terms of the behavior, description of the state of the system, description of the change of the state of the system, and description and understanding of the laws of nature. This will come across more often and in our series of lecture. Now there is a question whether you can predict the happening or phenomenon, or whether you can. So there can be many kinds of determinism, as we will come to know later. And however, in beginning with, we will deal with since classical physics, and in classical physics the nature is fully deterministic. So which means that the given the laws of nature, given the initial conditions, we are in position to determine what will happen and how the phenomenon will occur, and because nature is fully deterministic. So if you throw a ball and if you have complete knowledge of the speed, initial speed of throwing it, the angle of throwing it, the gravitational field and so on, then you can predict that at what distance it will fall, and if you perform the experiment, then you will find that it's a dropping at that same point which you have predicted. So that kind of fully deterministic nature, that what will happen, is available in classical physics. But when we will come to quantum physics, the new science, then we will be able to understand that nature is not fully deterministic as we find it now through scientific exploration, that nature has what we call probabilistic determinism. But if a scientific theory is such that it does not involve any kind of determinism, then also it would not be useful. So for a scientific theory to be useful, it is very, very essential that it should involve some kind of determinism. Since in beginning we will be only discussing classical theory, so we will be concerned with the fully deterministic nature of classical theory. This is the framework of a classical theory. So in a classical theory, you have a natural system, and this natural system will be encoded in the theory to a formal system. So in experiment, because I have said in experiment, maybe this natural system is accessible in experiment. So on the left hand side, I am characterizing the experiment, and on the right hand side, I am characterizing the theory. So what we do in our understanding, developing understanding of this natural system in the classical physics course, that we encode the natural system into a formal system. And a formal system is a mathematical system. It has nothing to do, or it's not a part of the nature in that sense. So this process of encoding is very, very important. For example, when you consider free fall of an apple, the free fall of an apple, the apple is a natural system, earth is a natural system, free fall is a natural phenomenon. But to understand that, we will develop a theoretical framework called Newtonian mechanics. And in that Newtonian mechanics, maybe we'll assume that apple is a particle and therefore located at a point, and we will describe apple as a particle located at certain height as a point in our description, theoretical description of the free fall of an apple. So that's the formal system. In the formal system, because it's a mathematical abstract system, we can do the mathematical manipulation. And there what we will do, that we will apply the laws of Newtonian mechanics or Newton's laws of motion, and then we will be able to predict that if the apple was initially at some height h from the surface of the earth, and given that the ignoring certain things and given the value of acceleration due to gravity, we will be able to compute the impact or the implication. And implication is that the apple, once released from that height h, will take certain time in free fall, and that free fall time can be calculated. And so we will be able to note that after this much time, the apple will touch the ground. Now, in the natural system, that experiment can be performed. And if we find that the kind of the formal system, so the formal system means that after this much time, it is vertically, it is at the surface of the earth. If that information is decoded into, again, the natural system, and if the same state the natural system is observed, then we say that the theory and experiments are in agreement. Let me repeat it. The recall of an apple will be considered, and at that time also I will use this slide again, that the apple is located, so apple is encoded to a particle, mathematics is applied, time of flight is calculated, experiment is performed. In experiment also the time of flight is measured, and we find that the time of flight measured in experiment is in agreement with the time of flight predicted by the theory, then we take for temporarily a relief in the theory, and we believe that theory provides an explanation of this phenomenon. So that is how we progress in classical physics. And it's very, very important to realize further again that this entire framework, the importance of the mathematical structure, the conceptual structure, and the fact that the theory must be falsified, because which means if from the decoding you points out to another state of the system or a state of the system which is not observed in the experiment, then the theory has been falsified. And till a theory is falsified, it is always in a tentative agreement. And that is why I more often emphasize the fact that the knowledge in science is tentative. The truth in science is tentative. It is never ultimate and final. But we aim that maybe in due course of time, we will have this capacity and having maybe perfect understanding of the nature. But that's just a dream like scenario. Now, another point which is very important, that as we progress in this course, and towards the end you will realize that scientific exercise or the learning of physics does not definitely involve experimental science and theoretical science only, but nowadays a third player is there, and that player is also very, very important. So it has become a triangular system, and that is a computation, because the kind of the systems which we are addressing to, we cannot understand a theory and an experiment, each of them, without involving computational science in you, without applying the computational science, considering it. And so there is a linkage between theory, experiments, and computational science in the journey of science, which will be explained and which you will encounter many times in this series of lecture. Now, this is the very first talk, and I would like to end my first talk as a prelude of the series with following quotes. Science is nothing but perception, as said by Plato. If you believe in science, like I do, you believe that there are certain laws that are always obeyed, so said by Stephen Hawking. Science never solves a problem without creating 10 more. George Bernard Shaw. And today, with this particular first lecture, our journey of understanding begins. In this journey, we will have tentative answers, tentative truth. Thank you very much, and keep watching the subsequent lecture in this series. The next lecture will be on kinematics of particles in one dimension. Thank you for being with us. A4 Science presents the very first lecture hands here.